Morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to everybody. We're really glad you're here and we're welcome, especially if you're new today. Today is Contemporary Music Sunday and Cheryl has a few announcements about that.
Well, the first announcement is about the music. The music packet that you got was a lot of copying, so we'd like to save them to use them in the future. So don't roll them up or fold them. And after the service is over, as you go back to get your muffins or your cookies and coffee, just lay them on the table in the vestibule and we can maybe use them again sometime. The second announcement is about Vacation Bible School, which will be at the end of June, and it will be at St. Peter's since they have air conditioning. But right now, the Vacation Bible School Committee is selling pretzel sandwiches to raise money to buy the materials for Vacation Bible School, and we only have 1 week to sell them. So the paper, if you want to order, the paper's on the vestibule and the table, and the money and the orders are all due next Sunday. Thanks.
Okay, thanks. And then also a week from Wednesday, there's a service at Wikidisco, Wednesday Lent services. And we used to have 5 churches. We were in a cluster birth, and now we're with 10 churches. And so they kind of are nervous about how many people are coming. So if you think you might come to that Wednesday Lent service, there's a sign-up sheet in the back. So please sign up. And then it'll be March 8th. It'll be here at Trinity, the Wednesday service at 7 and the meal at 6. Okay, today we're going to talk about what happy couples know. And they know sometimes you gotta throw things, and that's how fun. And we're gonna find out how to throw things, but not at your spouse. And let's please then join in the call to worship in the bulletin. O Lord, our Lord, your greatness is seen in all the world. Stars which you have set in their places.
What is mankind that you are mindful of them?
Yet you have crowned them with glory and honor.
O Lord, your grace is seen in all the world.
Thank you.
Now please join in our hymn, "Here I Am, Lord." It's in the contemporary hymnal, the first song. Be merciful to me, O God, because of your love.
Because of your great mercy, wipe away all my sins.
I have sinned against you, only against you.
I have done what you consider evil.
My sacrifice is a humble spirit, O God.
You will not reject the humble and repent of heart.
Let us confess our sins in silence. Here's the good news. Through Jesus Christ, all of our sins are forgiven. Amen. Please be seated. Gives it to another family. So right now, She has a pregnant pig and 3 sheep and 30 chickens, so they keep sharing what they have. They don't just keep it to themselves. They get a gift and then they keep on sharing. And so we can be part of that. We can help give a feed to somebody so that they can raise it for food because they can't, you know, go to the grocery store like we do. And so we can do that as we get to the One Great Hour sharing offering. And so we have a month until our offering. And so here's a little bank, and I'm going to give each of you a bank that you can take, and you can put whatever you want, pennies or quarters or whatever you want to put in there, and that will help people like Esmeralda to be able to do good and do well themselves. So here's a little, it's kind of like a bingo game. So have you ever played with a lonely person on the playground? Have you ever done that? Yeah, so you can put a little check there and put a coin in your bank for that because you share. And so there's all these different things you can do to see how many things you've done before. Picked up trash in the park or at school. I bet you've done a lot of things like that. Okay, so let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for sharing. We thank you that we can share and people have better lives when we do. So help us to continue to share with others in our everyday life, and it makes a difference. Amen. All right, thanks for listening. And now Rich Rico will read the scripture.
Because you are willing, as God wants you to be, not pursuing dishonor gain, but eager to serve, not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. In the same way, you who are younger, submit yourselves to your elders. All of you, clothe yourself with humility towards one another, because God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings. And the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen. The gospel reading from today is taken from Matthew chapter 7, verses 7 through 11, and is printed in your bulletin if you would like to follow after. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. And the one who knocks, the door will be opened. Which of you, if your son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a snake? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him? This is the good news.
Praise to you, Lord Christ. Our next hymn is Freely, Freely, and Cheryl and Melody will play through the whole thing since it's a new song before we start singing.
Thank you.
services, and we have a new service here at Trinity, and there's no music. It's a pretty quick service if you'd like to come to that one. And there's also one at St. Peter's in the evening with the full music, and that's very nice as well. And we're starting a new worship series with the Gospel of Luke, how Luke goes through the whole life of Jesus, and we hear about how Jesus really cared about outsiders, particularly in Luke. So that starts next Sunday, and we have a 40-day reading plan. So Lent is supposed to be 40 days. So what it is you start on Ash Wednesday, and you end the day before Easter, and you don't count Sundays. So that's how it's 40 days. If you want to do it exactly the way Lent is, or you can just read whatever you want, whenever you want. So just to help you as we kind of do this Luke thing as we go through Lent together. So today, you know, we all want to have happy, healthy relationships with our friends and family. And, you know, married, you want to be a happy couple. So that's what we're learning about. Today's the last message on what happy couples know. And we learned that when couples get married, each partner has their own kind of hopes, dreams, and desires that are, it's like a box, we think of them, which they are actually a box. But there's the things that we hope and dream that in our new relationship our partner will help us do or do for us, but over time, as we're married, they get to feel to our partner as if their expectations, like they're a burden. You know, I can't do all this, and you're not going to be happy if I don't. And the same thing happens when they, you know, take their hopes and dreams and desires, and they hand them to their, to the other partner, you know, to you. It's not something that you were looking for to take on. So it's best we learn to decide that our partner does not owe us. And then we learn happy couples are happy because they learn to defer to each other. It's a submission competition. You know, if you go last, you put your spouse first, it makes you a happier couple, and probably your spouse will start going last to put you first, and the happiness just builds. So, and today we're on the last topic we're going to talk about. Now, what do? You got your book box of hopes, dreams, and desires, and you realize your partner doesn't owe you to fulfill all these. And these things are hopes, dreams, and desires are things like, you know, how are we going to raise our kids? You know, if we have kids, and how will we resolve conflict? You know, will we do it the way I want to resolve conflict, or the way you want to resolve conflict? We'll have a conflict about conflict, and, you know, what we'll spend our money on, and what we'll not spend our money on. Or, you know, I'll get the car of my dreams, and you'll get the bill, you know. Where we'll live, who will mow the lawn. You know, when you first think about these things, and you start your marriage, you're excited about, well, you know, things are going to be great, but your partner has some different ideas and isn't so thrilled about everything that you want. So what do you do with all that stuff in your box? You know, the stuff you thought your spouse would love to do to help you be happy, but they're now like this box of expectations that are standing between you and your spouse. And, you know, no matter what it is in life, when we have feelings, it doesn't help to just ignore our feelings, to be quiet, and, you know, your disappointment then just eats you up inside. So it doesn't work to get busy and say, you know, well, you know, things aren't as happy at home, I'll just spend more time at work, or I'll spend more time with the kids, or I'll go out to the garage, or go shopping. You know, if you avoid or ignore your feelings, it doesn't feel good. So if you're not honest about what's important to you, you won't be happy, and your relationship won't be healthy. So sometimes a person in a relationship, you know, they kind of hit that wall where they realize, you know, all their hopes, dreams, and desires aren't going to be taken. taken care of by their spouse, and then they decide to go seek someone else. And they think, well, you know, there's somebody out there who gets me, you know, who's going to take seriously making me happy. And the new someone you meet, though, at first they're on their best behavior, and then, you know, the hormones are working, and it's all good, and then, you know, because they think you're the greatest person in the world. But once you get to know each other, and the newness wears off, and you're, you know, pushing what you want, they also don't want to get busy fulfilling all your expectations. So what can you do? You know, it's depressing to ignore what you want for a relationship, and, you know, if you try to find someone else, you're eventually going to get the same difficulty again, and after a while, you know, it's all a burden to them. So what do we do with what's in our box? And in the scripture, we get some help with difficulty in relationships. And we'll look at two scriptures about throwing things. You know, 1 Peter is a letter written to Christians in Asia Minor. And it's written to encourage Christians in a time of persecution. And so verse 6 says, humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. So this is encouragement to turn to God when things get difficult, right? Don't try to come up with your own scheme for how you'll fix this. You know, you go to God for help, and God will lift you up in due time. Verse 7 says, cast all your anxiety on him because he cares for you. And cast, you know, it means to throw, to hurl, to fling. You know, you take your burdens, your anxiety, your worries, and you throw it over to God. You can throw things, but not at your spouse. You know, not at whoever you're upset with. You can throw things, though, over to God. Because you have to do something with the stuff in your box, and your disappointment has to go somewhere. So you throw it over to God, because God cares for you. And God is not fragile. God can take it. So you cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Because your disappointment has to go somewhere, and God can take what you throw at him. In Psalm 55, the psalmist says, he's disappointed with this former best friend of his. In verse 12, he says, you know, if an enemy were insulting me, I could endure it. If a foe were rising against me, I could hide. But it is you, a man like myself, my companion, my close friend, with whom I once enjoyed sweet fellowship at the house of God as we walked about among the worshipers. And so, you know, we know it's rough when a close friend is now against you. And in marriage, you know, there's a closeness you have. And then when you feel disappointment, when you realize this person isn't going to make every hope and dream that you have come true, you know, things can get rough between you. But in this psalm, like in many places in the Old Testament, the followers of God do not act nice when they feel upset. They express to God exactly how they feel. In verse 15 of Psalm 55, the psalmist says, let death take my enemies by surprise. Let them go down alive to the realm of the dead, for evil finds lodging among them. And you know that's honest. And he is so angry. But they do that in the Old Testament, in the Psalms. Sometimes they really get mad, and you can say, boy, I don't know if you should be saying that to God, but they do. And the psalm writer, you know, he vents. Verses 16 and 17, then he goes in to ask, for me, I call to God, and the Lord saves me. Evening, morning, noon, I cry out in distress. distress and he hears my voice. So, you know, that's when you pray, evening, morning, and noon. And so what he's saying is he shows up very faithfully and he prays to God. He doesn't skip prayer. He gets on his knees before the Lord over and over and over, and God saves him. He cries in distress, and the Lord hears his voice. So verse 22 then is the throwing part, where he says, cast your cares on the Lord, and he will sustain you. He will never let the righteous be shaken. So don't hold your feelings in and don't ignore them. Instead, throw your worries over to the Lord and he will keep you keeping on. He will save you because your disappointment has to go somewhere and God can take whatever you throw at him. And, you know, I know there's people here in church today who have done this. They've had anxiety and distress and anger and fears and tears, and they took them to God. They cast their cares on the Lord. They persisted in coming to him, and he helped them, and he saved them. And how does God save us? He humbles us. You know, when you take your cares to God, the first remarkable thing God does isn't with your spouse, it's with you. You learn that marriage is not about you getting all that you wish for in life. You know, your spouse is not a genie in a bottle, but a marriage is about love and compassion and caring for your partner as much as you care for yourself. So God humbles us, and we may realize, you know, we've been trying to get something out of our spouse that they were never made to give. And as we take all our feelings to God and we pray and pray and pray, we might discover that we can let go of some of those things that were in our box. You know, I told you before, I was really disappointed. Kevin and I got married, and a few months later, I had a birthday, and I was disappointed. I thought he should have made a bigger deal about my birthday. You know, when I was a kid, my mom made me big birthday parties, you know, so that was in my box. I wanted a big to-do on my birthday. And I didn't even tell him, but I thought he should do it, you know? And so I learned, though, after that I could let go of that, you know? I don't want a big birthday party. And if I do, then I can just tell him, and I'm sure he'll care. So my challenge for you this week is, do you need to unload your feelings about your box and your relationship? Well, you start unloading with your Father in heaven. And don't be polite. You know, don't be try to hide things. Lay it all out for God and let all your anger out too. Get a microphone. Be honest. Throw all your feelings over to God. Cast your cares on him because he cares for you. And you know, I think one of the hardest things when someone yells at you, when someone insults you, is to reply, you know, with open hands and an open heart, saying things like, well, thank you for sharing for me what's inside of you. You know, that's really hard for us humans, and there are some people who can do it. You know, I can't do that, but it's really hard for your spouse, you know, if you let everything out on them, for them to say, well, thank you for sharing what's inside of you, you know. But it's easy for God. You know, people for thousands of years have brought anything to God. So if it's important to you, it's important to your Father in heaven. Your disappointment has to go somewhere, and God can take it. Whatever you throw at him. So cast all your anxiety on the Lord because he cares for you. And over time, you and your spouse may find that what you both really want is the same thing. You want to be happy together. Amen. Please stand and join as we affirm our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried.
Deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory,
our Pink Mandela, our scripture reader, Ms. Mitch Grinho, our ushers, our Dan Chai, and Kevin Williard. Our Sunday school teachers are Lori Bond and Jess Welker, and the bulletin was made by Ashley Burchett. And now go forth in the love of God, the peace of Christ, and the